think or what we feel. Feelings are not right or wrong. They just feelings. They don't nothing. Sometimes they're not even based on facts, truth at all. They just are feelings. So we have to learn to come together, sit down with each other. When we think that person has a problem with us, whatever it is, and all you can do is make an attempt. But you can't make nobody speak or get an understanding. But if you at least go to them in love, then maybe some of that will be rectified and dealt with. That's all I'm saying. I mean, that's what I tell my daughter. That's what I tell myself. And I'm bold enough to go to you and let's talk. I mean, I'm supposed to love you. So I'm going to talk to you. And that's where I think the love should come in. That we get an understanding of why we're feeling like this. And I think that'll stop a lot of it. Anybody agree with me? Does it sound right to anybody? Can I get an amen or something? I think that's the only way we're going to do it, is talk about it.
That's true. Thank you, Sister Elaine, and thank you, Brother Curtis. I want to say something about Brother Curtis. I've been knowing him for a while. Well, I actually met him when he first came to work at Wonder Bread. So that's been some years ago. But I didn't know him as Brother Curtis then, you know, because, you know, I wasn't in church, so. But I knew he was a religious man. I didn't know, you know, how different he was, but I can say that Curtis that I met then is a little bit different from the Curtis that I know now. He is more sensitive to other people than he was, I believe, when I first met him. I mean, I'm not saying he wasn't a caring person, because he's always been there. You know, I didn't fool around with people that didn't have a heart for other people, even when I was in the world. But I admire him for his drive, you know, to achieve excellence in the ministry, you know, especially when it comes to our leaders. You know, he always put his best foot forward when it comes to them, you know, and the needs of his church. And we can't, you know, ignore that or overlook that. I look at it as arrogance, because it's not. It's just God is driving him, you know, to excel, to do well. And we can only expect that, you know, that's what is expected of all of us. If we all had the drive and zeal to accomplish these things that we put our minds to do together, then it would all come so easy. You know, it would all just come together so nicely. But we do have to, you know, we do have to work with each other. Some, you know, we have to pull, you know, maybe turn on a little bit, get them to come along. And that's just life, not just the way it is. But in the end, when it's all said and done, when the founders is over with, or during that event, you know, we'll look at everything. The way the tables are set, the way the hall is decorated, the way everything, the way everybody is pulling together on that day. You know, it takes all of this to get us all to that day, to that point. And once we get there, you know, all I see is unity. You know, and that's what matters, is when it's time to come together. Somehow we managed to pull and come together, and everybody worked together for the same go for the same purpose, for the same reason. So so it takes someone to get it kicked off. And Brother Curtis is the perfect person that gets things kicked off, get things moving. And I admire him for that, you know. We do have some that, you know, we have to tug on, you know, to get them to, you know, release somebody, or to get them to even, you know, lend a helping hand. But like I said, but in the end, when it's all said and done, you know, I see nothing but unity, you know, with everybody. And I see so much love, with, you know, from everybody in the kitchen to everybody out there on the floor. You know, to everybody, you know, that's in this church. And like Brother Curtis said yesterday, when people outside the ministry see that unity and that love in a fellowship like this one, you know, they can't help but say good things about us. And I hear great things about this ministry all the time. You know, the only problem that I have with those people that say good things about this ministry is that that what we do here is too much for them. You know, most people just want to come to church and take a seat, be quiet, and get a good sermon, and then go home. This is not that kind of church. We are a church that's involved. We are the church. And if we ever let go of that, then this church will fail. So we are the body, we're the church. You know, we are what make it go. And we can't lose sight of that. We can't let one or two people, you know, throw a wrench in that. So no matter how it looks now, it never ends up that way. It always comes together. So I always look at the end result. I don't pay much attention to the things that's leading up to that, because I know how it's going to turn out. I know what it's going to be. I know what the end result is going to be. And that's what I keep in my mind. That's what drives me to do the things that I do, is seeing past people's feelings or emotions or what they think or what they don't think or what they might like or what they don't like. My goal is to see that whatever we put our minds to do, you know, it gets done. And it's for all of us. You know, what I do for this church, I do for you, for this ministry, you know, for my sisters and brothers. And that's the joy, that's the pleasure that I get, you know, when I see all of you happy, when I see all of you in fellowship, when I see all of you loving and hugging on each other. You know, that's what gives me joy. And that's what I live for. And I know that's, you know, what Curtis live for, and you, Sister Irene, Sister Sharon, you know, all of us. All of us regular people, all of us who are here, you know, that's what we live for. You know, so we just have to just keep it all in focus. You know, just don't look at what didn't go right today. Always keep your mind on the day of, when everything comes together, because God is not going to let it fail. And it's up to us not to don't make it any harder than what it, you know, what it is. So we just have to keep, you know, just keep our eyes on the prize. And the prize is having a wonderful Founders Day and celebrating our pastors and enjoying a wonderful fellowship with them and with each other. So that's, you know, that's the goal. That's what we're doing, and that's how I look at it. That's how I see it. Amen. So I'm gonna take a moment here. Brother Jonathan. I'll put you on the spot. You want to come on down for a minute? There's some of the wonderful things that happen in this ministry that we don't pay much attention to. But I've been watching this young man, you know, since I've been here. And I've, you know, seen the things that he's had to go through and what young people go through, you know, in their lives. And to see him to come down to this altar like he did yesterday and give his heart to God, you know, recommitted himself to Christ. Because I know his parents, you know, been put a lot of prayer in. And it ain't just them. We all been praying for them. And we became a father and stuff. And that's, you know, sometimes it takes that, to lift our young people up and give them, put them on the right course. And what I saw yesterday morning with Jonathan, his mind is set in the right direction. You know, he's on the course. You know, that's going to be pleasing to God and to his family, and especially to his baby. So, if you have a word you'd like to share.
Been going through a lot of stuff lately. You know, you try to do stuff your own way, you try to go on your own path, backslide, not listen to God, the ways of the world, feel good. But stuff kept happening to me. I was getting kicked out of my houses, losing jobs, getting pulled over by cops and all kinds of stuff, I think that was just all signs and things that God just telling me to come back to him. And I come back to church for a little bit, try to pray, whatever. And then I go back and doing what I would do. When I was coming to church, good things were happening to me. God be blessing me. And then when I strayed away, God's like, God took his hand off me. He said, I want to protect you, but if you're doing all that sin and stuff, I can't help it. I just get tired of that after a while. It's like, I just gotta be serious this time. I can't keep going back and forth, And so that's what I'm trying to do now, I've been in this church ever since I was born. And I know better. And so, this time I'm trying to be serious with him.
Praise God. Praise the Lord. Yeah, that's good.
Sit next to him on the pew yesterday, almost brought me to tears. When you've been out there, the pain, people like you, what they're going through, and to see them, submit and say, I can't do it anymore. It's just, God just loves us so much, and he wants so much for us. Even when we're way off track, he never really has takes his hand off of us. He may just let you go a little bit, but in the midst of all of that, he blessed John and his fiance with a beautiful baby. So God is always doing things even when we don't see it, even when we're in sin. Things be happening on our behalf because he knows who we are and he knows where we've been. And a young man like Jonathan, he knows where Jonathan come from, where he belongs. You know, so God went all the way around the block, you know, because he couldn't come straight to him. Well, he came straight at him, but, you know, like most of us do, God come right at us. We have a tendency to, block it, you know, throw up defenses and stuff. So when we do that, you know, then God just find another way, you know, so. And his way was giving Jonathan, you might say he started his life over through the life of a new child. So he's, so this is his second chance. He'll have opportunity to do for his son what his parents did for him. Raised them in this church, and I believe that that curse that may have fallen on Jonathan won't fall on their child. You know, what you did yesterday was break the generational curse, and you know, so you you know, so this is what God wants us to do. You know, we have the ability to break curses of our lives, you know, if we just humble ourselves and submit to God. No curse is permanent unless we allow them to be. So God always wants the best for us, no matter how we think or act or how we see the world. He always wants the best for us. It is up to us to grasp it and hold on to it. How we can obtain it, it's there for us. So I appreciate the young man that came back, you know, to start over and start it over so that their child, you know, won't have to go through what he went through, won't stray and get lost. So, you know, I'm a great, you know, breaking generational curses. That's my pet peeve. And that's one of the things that I live for, you know, because so many people think that because this happened to them or happened to their parents or something like that, that they're a curse and this is what it is for them. But that is not the case. It's only that way that we are allowed to be. So we don't have to be, well, not those two parents, but like other people who have parents that were not in the church, that were outlaws and hoodlums, alcoholics, drug addicts, and things like that. We don't have to be our parents. We don't. And we only do that because people say you'll be just like your dad or just like your mom, you know, just because you make a couple of mistakes in your life. And we buy into it and decide that, okay, that's who I am, that's who I am. But that's not who you are. That's not who you are. You're only that because you allow yourself to be. So, if anybody, Brother Wayne, you have something you'd like to share with us?
experience yourself, just know you need to have a touch from him to help you go through the things that you might be experiencing. And nobody can be like Jesus. I mean, nobody can be like him. You know, how he, you know, just can melt all the different characters and everything that you might be experiencing when you come in here, where sometimes you smack, you can't just get that exact breakthrough in your house that you desire. But when you come amongst the people of God, thank God for the anointing that's on this church and important on amongst the people of God that are seeking God and praying, that he allows people to get their release and breakthroughs and being delivered and set free from whatever might have took place that week. And thank God for the prayer to continue to go up on the behalf of the people. Because I believe that God answered our prayers and working in our favor. And just to encourage you to continue to lift up the brothers and sisters and all those that are standing in the forefront with us. And I need your prayer, and that's why we come out and do what we do, to pray for one another, being a seed on the behalf, and the names that come up before you, because you don't know what that next person is going through that week or what they may have experienced. And I can rest assured that the enemy is persecuting you. The reason why you don't see the people is because they're being persecuted. They are facing, you know, their trials and their tribulations. Some of them know how to, you know, almost like wandering around in the wilderness. They don't know how to get out of it. But somehow or another, through the encouragement of the saints, by their call, encouraging them to come out to prayer, see God, more to press into him. And as they come and gather amongst us, God will remove that veil, that darkness over their eyes, and allow them to see. So what God has done in your life, you know, and then they will encourage them to come to prayer, come out to Bible study, and so forth. And just have to continue to bring their names before the Lord. And as we intercede on them, on their behalf, God begin to deal with them, and then to give them release. So they can recognize God is with them wherever they might be facing. But sometimes they get defeated by the enemy so much that they just can't see the way out. And because so many things continue to happen to them, one after another. And we know, I mean, every person right here experiences, you know, different experiences all through the week. And likewise, you know, the other people as well, particularly, I say even the more the ones don't come. Just been like drowning the things they might be experiencing. But that's why we come out here to intercede and pray. And even in your house, to bring people the name in this body, this particular body, and different ones that come across your mind. And you know, you can take things even further, you know, God lay them on your heart and give them a call to them, you know, think about you. You know, I'm praying for you, you know, believing God for you. And then we see God working, you know, in miraculous ways and on their behalf. And then in situations you're experiencing, before you know it, you receive your prayer. I mean, you know, sometimes you think that even myself saying like, well, I don't need no prayer for what have you. But he do. I mean, you know, like I said, we all do need. But I always say, well, if you pray for me, first thing I'm going to do is remind you, I'm going to pray for you. I don't ask you to do nothing for me that I don't do for you. And so, you know, and that's how I live my life. And God has rewarded me that in that effort in doing that. But yet the people that, you know, the enemy is showing up on attack, those in the forefront, those that pray, those that seek God. He's going to make sure you continue to bring up different things in our lives. And that's why we have to continue to press in. You know, sometimes you might not see me on Monday night. I mean, through whatever, different appointments or whatever, other things are going on. But I try my best to press to get out here. Now, Monday night, I try to press in on Wednesday. So if you, like I said, you don't see the regulars, you know there's something going on in their lives, just pray for them. God bless them. Help them whatever they're going through. Because, you know, our pastor needs to be encouraged, you know, and admonish you continually, you know. how well of a job that they're doing. And I could only imagine, you know, I could just only imagine what they're experiencing. And you think what we going through, can you imagine the responsibility of this church falling up on their shoulders and trying to maintain, you know? I mean, that's a tough job. I mean, really tough job. And so we have to pray for them and encourage them. Let them know that we, you know, that we with them, and just show their kindness to them, and to stand with them in this time, and be, you know, also be, and do the work of the family, do the thing that we know to do as saints, you know, just reaching out to others and praying for others, and, you know, speaking, encouraging folks about the Lord, and then to draw people in, you know, and those members that seem like they're not coming to their discipline, give them a reminder and call, and just thinking about you. And different people I run across or out and about, whatever, that I hadn't seen for a while. I continue to remind them about different events that are taking place that's coming up within the church. And let them know that, hey, we still love them. We miss you. We hope we get a chance to see you soon. Not to put no guilt trip on them, but to show them kindness, you know.
Amen.
And we're not, you know, putting no, you know, condemnation about it, but we draw them with the love of Christ. And just continue to do that little bit. I think things will change for the better. I'm alive. Here's our brother here, you know. Brother, just, you know, we're with you. I mean, sometimes you know how family are. If when you know how family are, we know how they act sometimes. And that's what we hear, you know, and I know my family that I've met them with. Sometimes, you know, they fed up. They don't act according to the way Brother Wayne wants. You know, I would love for them to see them do every exact thing that I want the way I want to. But it just don't happen that way. You know. And most of the time, my family, I don't always, I don't have a, you know, like, thundering voice, you know, not all the time. Every once in a while, just reminds me I'm still in the room. But, you know, but usually when I get, you know, it's when I find them by themselves. Ain't nobody there for me and them. That kind of where I remember my father, how he was with us. The whole week, he wouldn't say nothing. Nothing to us when we cutting up. I don't know how to say nothing. Before a weekend comes, like a check recorder being played about everything you did. He remembered. I mean, you know, but that's how, you know, I kind of deal with my kids around. Sometimes I get them along, but I begin to, you know, speak to them about some things and so forth. But different people got different personalities. And we always have to locate people's strengths and deal with, you know, work with those strengths, because not everybody can do, you know, different things. And the only time that's going to come about is through fellowship. Find out where people are, how they, what they're about. Because, you know, I'm not a type of person that, you know, because sometimes I'm always not always speak my mind, because sometimes I might come across in a negative way. That's why a lot of times I was told that. But until the moment comes when I'm with you or whatever, in your presence about it, then you got to kind of explain to you how I am, what I expect, you know, for me and how I am. But on the time that really kindred spirit comes, it's more fellowship. That way we know how this person is, this person is. Because certain things, you know, certain people, you know, they ain't, you know, they might not be there, you know. But that's come by learning. That's through my family. There's certain tasks. You know, I got, you know, $3 or $4. I say $3 or $4. Certain things I know they ain't gonna do. I mean, sometimes I challenge them. I ask them still, but I know they don't want to do that. And man, when I do, they just don't think, they just don't act, just act up sometimes. Because I have crossed a boundary of oracles that's not, you know, part of their makeup. But yet, do I, you know, just love them, don't love them because of the way I know how they are? No, I just know about them. Then I come back again with something I know they would enjoy doing. And that's how we have to learn from each other to find out, okay, what the more strength is and work with it, you know, and that way make things work a little bit smoother. But anyway, like I said, it's encouraging. Thank you, all your brothers and sisters, for being here. Thank you for your prayers and encouragement. Like I said, if you're your leaders, you need to pray for them, walk up and talk to them, shake their hand, and just tell them maybe how good of a job they're doing. You just don't know how good how well that does sometimes. We don't always have, I know we don't have always big money, but just to shake hands sometimes, just work, you know. And anyway, just thank y'all for that.
All right, thank you, brother. All right, light is there. All right, come on up. I love these testimonials. Good for the soul.
This is also for Brother Jonathan. I just want to congratulate you because I know exactly what you've been, what you're going through. I remember when James, I had to make it out to have my first child. And it's a big step. One lifestyle, start another. It's a blessing that you was raised in the church because you know to turn back to the church. I know a lot of people don't know to turn back to the church. Mm-hmm. Same situation happened to me. Believe it or not, about twice a day a month. Man, that's the same me to be getting in this type of issues. But I see those ones, I knew how to give something up for something. Stay focused, don't be discouraged. The only person out there is going to try to discourage you in all kind of ways. Stay prayed up, and as long as you see the enemy coming, you know you get the right thing. Can you encourage that? Rather.
For their children. It's just too easy today to let somebody else do it. And this is one of the things that we have to work on and talk about and try to get past it because we're people that's being, you know, we're experiencing genocide. We will slowly get wiped off the face of this earth. When our young men are dying, abandoning their children, we're losing generations of people. Constantly, you know, it's And it's sad, you know, we're being wiped off the face of the earth. And, you know, a lot of us, you know, are too old to be trying to get back out and start Baptist. You know, start Baptist again. We need our young men to keep producing our young children and not just making them, you know, but being there for them, being the father, not just the daddy. And once we can turn that thing around, we as a nation of black people will be so much better off. We'll have so much pride and authority in this land. We have so much to live for, so much to give to the world. Instead of getting our money to funeral homes and places like that. So I take my hat off to these young brothers, you know, who decided that they're not going to be part of that trend, you know, that's causing our generation to disappear. So, you know, I thank God for them. I thank God for this church. And I thank God that He has a hand on them. It's like He has a hand on so many of our youth. They're just running and blind. Like Brother Wayne said, you know, they're just blind. And it's up to us to take those blinders off. And show them what real men, who real men are, what real men do, you know, in this world. And that's take care of their home, take care of their children, their families, and be there for them. So, if nobody have anything else, Brother Curtis, he's been taking time with J-Time and stuff in mind. My other nephews, these are the things that, you know, that's starting to change, it's starting to turn around, you know. We're starting to, this gym, Reeves Foundation, it's an amazing thing that they're doing over there. They're investing in our young black men, heavily investing in them, teaching them morals and teaching them things that we take for granted, you know, teaching them discipline. So that gym over there is doing a great thing for all of you. And hopefully when they get a new building, if they ever get one, I believe that they'll be able to grow and bring in even more young men and stuff and help turn their lives around. It's a great thing that they're doing. For the community and for our people. So with that, I'll close this out in prayer. Our Father who art in heaven, we thank you for this day, Lord. We thank you, Father, for those who came forth and poured out their hearts to you. We thank you, Father, for the love you shone on them, giving them the confidence, the desire, and giving them hope and letting them know that you are and have always been their God, that you are always here, have always been here, even when we didn't see you or feel you or know you. We thank you, Lord, for all the work you're doing in this ministry through our pastors, through the members, through this 5-4 ministry. We thank you, Father, for all the help, the finances, for all of the hands-on that's coming out of our sisters and brothers here at Northside. Father, this church is heavily anointed with anointing people because you wish it so, you desire it so, and we can only honor you tonight with our praise, with our love, And we thank you, Father, for being our God, our Father, our Creator, our peace, our joy, our protector, our healer, everything that we need, that's who you are. So tonight, we give you praise, we give you glory, we give you honor. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.